Okay. In this lecture now, what we are going to look at is some other characteristics of nonlinear systems, which is equally important. Typically, when you talk about nonlinear systems, we want to analyze. Of course, if you are looking at a nonlinear system without any inputs, then what you would like to analyze is are the equilibrium points, and you want to find out whether the equilibrium points are stable or unstable, what sort of characteristics the equilibrium point has. Now, another characteristic which nonlinear systems display are limit cycles. So, there are these limit cycles that could exist in a nonlinear system, and one would like to know whether these limit cycles are stable, unstable, and so on. Now, of course, this has a lot of practical use. Like, for example, oscillator circuits are designed by using nonlinear circuits, such that the nonlinear circuits actually have a limit cycle, which is a stable limit cycle. So, what happens is when the circuit traverses through this limit cycle, it's a stable limit cycle. So, if there is any sort of perturbance, you sort of get deviated from the path. But because it's stable, it comes back to the path, and therefore this limit cycle keeps getting described again and again. Now, one important thing about the limit cycle is that suppose you draw a phase plane diagram of this nonlinear system. So, you have this limit cycle, which is really a closed curve in the phase plane. Now, if the system is evolving along a limit cycle, and you look at, you sense the signal somewhere in your system, because it is going through this limit cycle, the signal that you sense would be periodic. So, if one wants to analyze or detect limit cycles in a nonlinear system, then necessarily there must be periodic solutions, if you're sensing the nonlinear circuit somewhere, you should be getting periodic signals. So, one could now utilize this idea of periodicity in signals to try and capture limit cycles in a nonlinear system. Now, from what we had discussed earlier, if you have a general nonlinear system, then you can split it up into a linear part and a nonlinear part, and think of a linear part as an independent system and the nonlinear part as an independent system with some feedback connection. So, you could think of the linear plant as being in the forward loop and the nonlinearity in the backward loop, and some sort of negative feedback loop that you have. And analyzing this closed loop system is the same as analyzing the original nonlinear system. Okay, so let's look at what it is that I'm saying. So suppose you have some nonlinear equation, and this we have discussed in some earlier lecture. You can split it up into a linear part and a nonlinearity, and then think of the original nonlinear system to be analyzing the original nonlinear system is like analyzing this closed loop system. Okay, now in this system, suppose you look at this, you have some methodology by which you can see the signal that exists at this place. Now, if this system is going through a limit cycle, so you have the phase plane, so suppose it was a order 2 system, so you have x and x dot, and if it's an order 2 system and it has a limit cycle, maybe it has a limit cycle which looks like that. Okay, and so let's suppose that the given system is traversing through this limit cycle. Okay, so if it starts from this point at time t equal to t naught, after some time capital T, it will get back to this original point. So what it means is that it will get back to this point So it was at this point a T naught. The next time it would be a T naught plus capital T, then T naught plus 2T, and so on. And so the periodicity is, so the period is T. And if you are sensing the signal here, the what you would get would be periodic signal like that. I mean, this being the period, and this period, this is capital T, and this keeps getting repeated. Now, when you have a nonlinear system, one would like to know if it has limit cycles, and if it has limit cycles, then whether the limit cycles are stable or not, and things like that. Okay. So, one way that one could detect limit cycles is by, you know, sampling or seeing these signals, let's say on an oscilloscope or something, and then if that signal is periodic, then you know that this system is right now oscillating in a limit cycle. But analytically, if one wants to find out if this given system has a limit cycle, then one of the methodologies used is what's called the method of harmonic balance. Now, the method of harmonic balance is based on some basic principles of periodicity. You see, for the linear plant, if you give as an input to the linear plant, if you give a periodic signal, and the most common periodic signals that we think of are the sine or the cosine waves. So, if you give a periodic signal as the input to the linear plant, the output of the linear plant will also be a sine or a cosine. The only difference being that the amplitude might have got magnified. Yeah, that's, and in fact, if you give a signal with frequency omega, then you know that the output signal for the linear plant would have magnitude, and the magnitude was, let's say, A, so you give a signal like A sine omega naught T, then the output would be G J omega naught. I mean, you evaluate what the transfer function would be at omega naught and take the modulus of that times A, okay? So the magnitude would be, or the amplitude, if the amplitude of the input was A, the amplitude of the output is A times the magnitude of G J omega naught. And then what you would get is sine omega naught T plus some alpha. This alpha would in fact be, that alpha would in fact be the angle of G J omega naught. So this is what happens in a linear plant. On the other hand, in a nonlinear plant, I mean, and in fact this property that when you give a pure sinusoid as an input to a linear plant, you get a pure sinusoid of the same frequency as the output to the linear plant, is in fact the defining property of linear plants. On the other hand, in a nonlinearity, when you give a sinusoidal input, the output that you get may not, I mean, for example, if you give the input to be a sinusoid, the output may not be sinusoid. But of course, depending upon the nonlinearity, when the input is a sinusoid, the output may still be a periodic signal having a period which is the same as the period of the input signal. So, what one does is one tries to use this idea. So, suppose you have a nonlinearity. So, what you do is, as input to the nonlinearity, you give sinusoidal input to the nonlinearity. Okay, so sinusoidal input with a particular frequency omega and the magnitude A. Now, as an output, you get something, but this something, of course, need not have. It would be periodic. Depending upon the nonlinearity, it may be periodic. Now, if it is periodic, what one could do is So if the output is periodic, what one could do is one could take a Fourier series of the output. Okay. Now, if you put certain kinds of constraints on the type of nonlinearity, then if you give a periodic input, you can say more things about the output. So, for example, if this nonlinearity is a memoryless nonlinearity, okay, which is time invariant, of course, memoryless is not that important, but suppose this nonlinearity is time invariant. Okay. Now, the nonlinearity being time invariant essentially means that if you give a certain type of input now, there is some output you get. But if you give the same input after some time capital T, then the output that you will get will again be the same. Now, if the nonlinearity is time invariant, then when you give a sinusoid with you know, the period being capital T, so suppose you give a sinusoidal input and this period here is capital T, okay, then the output, of course, you don't expect it to be a sinusoid, but you expect it to be something which is also having period T. Now, if the output signal has period T, then what one can do is you find the Fourier series of this output. Okay. Now, if you find the Fourier series of the signal, and okay, so let me call this signal phi of T, the input, let us say, was psi of T, and the output of the nonlinearity was phi of T. And so, if you write down the Fourier series of phi of T, what you would get is some constant term, let me call it B naught, plus you will have B1 sine omega being the same frequency that you give, omega T, plus B2 sine 2 omega T, because omega T has periodicity T, sine 2 omega T will have periodicity T by 2, and therefore, you know, the time period T is a multiple of that, and so on. So, this will also be a signal which is having time period T plus B3 sine 3 omega T, and so on. And then you might also get C1 plus C1 cos omega T, which is also some signal which has periodicity period time period equal to capital T, plus C2 cos 2 omega T, plus so on. Okay. So, this periodic signal phi T in fact can be completely characterized by if we know B0, B1, B2, B3, and so on, and C1, C2, and so on. Okay. So, now, as far as the nonlinearity is concerned, you give an input psi t, which is a sinusoid, sine, let us say, omega t, A sine omega t, and as an output, you get this signal phi t, and it has the same period, capital T, as the input. And what you do is you take the Fourier series. So, when you take the Fourier series, you get phi t to be, let us say, B naught plus summation B I sine I omega t, I going from 1 to infinity, a very large number, plus summation I going from 1 to infinity C I cos I omega t. Okay. Now, if this nonlinearity was not a nonlinearity but was a linearity, suppose this nonlinearity was, I mean, this was not really nonlinear but it was linear. If it was linear, then this B naught would not be there, and the B i's and the C i's, the B i's and the C i's, for all I not equal to 1 would have been 0, and you would have had a, let me use not I but K, because I can have some other meaning, so I'll just substitute K here. Okay, so K equal to 1, BK equal to B1 and C1 would be non-zero and all the others would be 0. And then what you have is B1 plus J times C1. This in fact is going to be, if it was a linear plant, so let's say if it was G of S, then this B1 plus C1 is really going to be A times G of J omega. One does is one assumes that this nonlinearity is not, I mean, one assumes the closest linear system to this nonlinearity by saying that if you give A sin omega t as the input, then the output is really B1 sin omega t plus C1 cos omega t. Okay, of course, this can be put together. This can be put together as B1 plus J C1 sin omega t. Maybe I shouldn't call it. I could do this. I could just call it B1 plus J C1 sin omega t. By saying JC1, what I am saying is that there is a component with this magnitude which is lagging the sine omega t by pi by 2. Okay. Of course, this could also be written out as you take the magnitude B1 squared plus C1 squared, and then you have sine omega t plus alpha, where alpha is this angle which this complex number would have. So now, this number that you have, you can think of this as the gain, and this as the phase of the nonlinearity when the frequency is omega and the amplitude is A. And so, for a given nonlinearity, what one could do is one could keep varying these various omegas, and for each omega, you vary the amplitude A. And so, for each omega and each amplitude, you find out what the gain is and what the phase is. Okay? So, what I am saying is, you have a function phi which has omega, the frequency of the input, and A, the magnitude of the input. So, it has these two, this function has omega and A as the input, and for this nonlinearity, so suppose I call the nonlinearity n, so I call this phi of n, so phi of this nonlinearity is such that given an omega and given the amplitude, it gives the gain g and the phase phi, or okay, let me call it alpha since I call this thing alpha. So, it gives the gain and the phase obtained in this way. So, how do you obtain this? Well, what you do is you take the input to be the sinusoid with this particular amplitude, you look at the output, and the output then you take the Fourier series of the output. Okay? You neglect all the higher harmonics and look at only the primary harmonics. So, you look at only B1 and C1. And that B1 and C1 together you use to calculate what the gain is and what the phase is. And so, this gain and the phase you put down as G and alpha. All right. So, now such a function, so this function of course takes as input the omega and the amplitude and gives as an output the gain and the angle. Okay. Now such a function is called a describing function. Of the nonlinearity. Okay. Yeah. One thing that I would like to clarify here is that, of course, when you just take the B1 and the C1, you get this. So this will not be the G, the gain. If you want to talk about the gain, this would have been the gain had the amplitude been 1. But right now the amplitude that I am giving is A. So this gain G is really square root of B1 squared plus C1 squared divided by A. Okay. Depending upon the amplitude, you see by how much. So the gain is precisely the number by which you should multiply the amplitude, the input amplitude, to get the output amplitude. I hope that is clear. So the gain is really, you look at the Fourier series, you look at B1 and C1, so you look at the magnitude B1 squared plus C1 squared, square root of that, but then you divide it by the amplitude of the input signal. So this gain, you purely, whatever is the magnitude of the gain, you multiply to the amplitude of the input signal to get the amplitude of the output signal. So this particular function is called the describing function. Now the best way to understand a describing function is to probably look at an example of a describing function. So what we will do now is we will take a particular nonlinearity and we will look at how one calculates this describing function. Okay. So the nonlinearity we look at, so let us look at the sine function. So we are looking at a nonlinearity. Okay, so nonlinearity, and the nonlinearity does the following: if the input is psi t, the output is the sine of psi t. Okay, the best way to draw this nonlinearity, the characteristics of this nonlinearity, is that the input is psi, the output, when psi is positive, it gives plus 1. And when psi is negative, it gives minus 1. Of course, instead of just taking sine, one could also just take, let's say, capital M times the sine, in which case here you'll have M, here you have minus M. Okay. Now, for this given nonlinearity, let's find the describing function. So now, suppose psi t, you give psi t to be a sinusoid. So assume that psi t is a sinusoid A sine omega t. Okay, what do you expect the output to be? So this is phi, the output. So in this case, the output, okay, so maybe I'll draw it like this. So here is the input. Yeah, so it's a sinusoid. So this is the input psi t. So this axis is t, and let's see what the output looks like. Well, the output will be plus m till this point, then it will be minus m till this point. So the output that you get is a square wave. So now if the output is a square wave, of course this is also periodic with the same time period as the original input. So now one can find out the Fourier series. Okay, so how does one find the Fourier series? So this particular sequence, this square wave is essentially, if I am taking that, this phi of t could be written as plus m for 20, KT and K plus half T, and minus M for K plus half T less than equal to T less than equal to K plus 1 T, where T is the time period of the signal. So it's the same as T is really the same as 2 pi by omega. So now if you find the Fourier series, okay, so how does one find the Fourier series for this the square wave? Well, so the Fourier series for the square wave is found by, okay, so for example, BK, the way you would find BK is multiply phi t to sine k omega t, and then take the integral over a period. So here, of course, omega t, so in case of t, if you are taking the period in case of t, you could take this integral from 0 to 2 pi by omega, that's capital T, which is the same as capital T, okay. And then this, okay, this, there would also be a multiplication factor here. The multiplication factor, let me just call it K, capital K. So this multiplication factor will depend upon how you take this integral, but if you are taking this integral over the whole period, then in that case K is going to be 1 by pi, 1 by 2 pi. Okay, so for this particular nonlinearity that we were looking at, so we have the square wave, and this is m plus m, this is minus m. So suppose we have to, okay, so this is how you find BK, and how you find CK is, again, you have the proportionality constant and 0 to capital T phi T cos k omega t. This phi t cos omega t, by multiplying by cos and taking the integral, will give us the c case. And of course, the b naught you get by just integrating 0 to t of phi t. Okay. Now, in this case, when you calculate, it should be clear that if you take any, if you evaluate any of the C case, in this particular case, you see what you have got here is an odd function, and any odd function, if you are going to, I mean, if you have a periodic odd function and you are going to take the Fourier series, all the C case will turn out to be 0. Okay. On the other hand, if you calculate the B case, in this particular case, you will get B1 to be M by, you will get 4M by pi, if I am not mistaken. Okay, maybe, perhaps I should just calculate it out. Okay. So, let me calculate B1. So this B1 is like integrating from 0 to pi, 0 to pi of m times sine theta d theta, okay, plus integral from pi to 2 pi of minus m sine theta d theta, Okay, but this integral is really the same as this integral. Of course, there's some constant, so I'll fix the constant later. So this is the same as 2 times integral from 0 to pi m sine theta d theta. Now this, okay, so I can pull out the m, so I have 2m, and I have integral of sine theta is minus cos theta evaluated at pi and 0, and so this should give me cos theta evaluated at pi is 1, cos theta at 0 is also 1, so I get 4m. Okay. As it turns out that this whole thing is 1 by pi of this whole thing, so it is 2 by pi here, 2m by pi, 4m by pi. So, so I was right here in the first place, this constant k should have been 1 by pi. Okay. So this b1 turns out to be 4m by pi. In general, we can see that bk will turn out to be, so if you have to calculate bk, this is like, okay, so if you evaluate all the bk's, these bk's will turn out to be 4 times km by pi. No, sorry. Maybe we just calculate B3. So B3 turns out to be 1 upon pi. And now you have to take the integral from 0 to pi of m, 2 times of m sine 3 theta d theta, which is 2m by pi, and this integral is minus cos 3 theta by 3 evaluated at 0 and pi. Okay, and so this turns out to be, okay, so that is 1/3 plus 1/3, that's 2/3, so you get 4m by 3 pi. Yeah, so in general, when you calculate bk, what you're going to get is 4m by k pi. Okay, I have to be a bit careful here, because I am going to get bk equal to 0 when k is even and equal to 4m by k pi when k is odd. Okay, why I'm saying this is because we are looking at a square signal, a square wave like this. And so suppose I take a sinusoid, which is an even multiple. Yeah, you see, so suppose I am taking an even harmonic, then if you look at the first half, the positive thing is multiplying the sign, and then the second half, it's a negative thing which multiplies the same signal. As a result, when you do the integral, which is what you are doing to calculate, so in order to calculate B2, then B2 will turn out to be 0, because there's as much positive as there's negative. On the other hand, if I'm looking at the primary harmonic, then that's the positive half and that's the negative half. So when it was positive, this was also positive, and that's negative, this is also negative. So the B1 turns out to be, as we saw, 4m by pi. Yeah. So whenever you take odd harmonics, odd harmonics bk will turn out to be 4m by k pi, whereas for the even harmonics it will turn out to be 0. But anyway, we are not concerned with all this, all the full Fourier series. What we are only concerned with is this particular thing, p1. Okay, so now coming back to the nonlinearity, so you have this nonlinearity, and when the input is psi t, the output is phi t. And what we have just seen is when the input psi t is A sine omega t, then the output phi t is a square wave with magnitude capital M. And so, if you want to talk about the gain is going to be 4m by pi, 4m by pi, as we looked at the Fourier series of the output of the square wave, we saw that b1 was 4m by pi and c1 was 0. So, the output, the primary harmonic of the output, the primary harmonic of the output is going to be 4m by pi sine omega t. And therefore, if you want to now talk about the describing function for this nonlinearity phi of n, then phi of n of omega a is going to be 4m by pi a. Okay. With angle 0. Okay, why is the angle 0? The angle is 0 because when you give a sinusoid, the output of the primary is in phase with the input. Yeah, so there is no angle alpha here, that is why the angle is 0. And when the primary and the input is A, we saw that the output magnitude is 4m by pi. So, the gain is the output magnitude divided by the input magnitude, that is why it is 4m by pi a. So, the describing function for this particular nonlinearity is 4m by pi a. Note that this nonlinearity, the describing function is independent of omega. So, it really does not matter what this omega is. As you change the omega, you get periodic signal of a different time period, but then the analysis for B1 and C1 is exactly the same as what we have done before. And so, again you will get the magnitude to be 4m by pi. Yeah, it does not matter what this omega is. You will always get 4m by pi sin omega t as the output if A sin omega t is the input for whichever omega you think of. So, that is why the describing function, though I am writing here that it is a function of both omega and A, it really is only a function of A. This omega does not play a role. So, in this particular nonlinearity, we could suppress omega if we felt like it, and we could just think of the describing function as only depending upon the input magnitude A. Now, one can also look at describing functions of more, that was probably a very simple nonlinearity. One could look at other nonlinearities like for example, one can look at a nonlinearity which is, let us say, a relay with dead time. Yeah. So, if you look at the input-output characteristics of such a relay with dead time, so this is the input, this is the output, and it could be that for some time, for some input, there is no output, and then there is an output, and here similarly, for some negative inputs, there is no output, and then there is an output, and let us say this magnitude is again m, and this is minus m. So, up to some value d, there is no output. Beyond d, you get plus m, and similarly up to minus d, there is no output, and beyond that you get minus m. So, you have a nonlinearity with this characteristics. Now, suppose to this nonlinearity you give an input which is A sine omega t. Okay. Now, if you give an input A sine omega t, what would be the output? So let me write down what the output is. So phi t would be equal to, okay. So let me mark what one would get as an output by doing something here. So let me draw the sinusoid here, and then I can just directly check what the output would be, because on this axis, if I draw the input like this, then I can check what the output is. So suppose the input is like this. Yeah, so some sinusoid like that, where the magnitude A is less than the small d. Now you see, if the magnitude A is less than small d, then when this is the input, the output, as you can read off from this map, is 0. So the phi t will be 0 if the magnitude A is less than d. Okay. On the other hand, if you consider input where A is greater than d, then what's going to happen is, okay, so that's d, and that's minus d for you. So what will the output look like? So let me draw output here. So initially, this is how the sine wave took off. So initially, for this much time, so up to this point, for this much time, the input is 0. Then for this portion of the input, it is plus m. Then after that, it becomes 0, and it is 0 for all this time. So it is 0 for all this time. And then it goes negative. Okay. And then it again becomes 0. And this could be the time period t. Okay, I could also write this as, let's say, 2 pi. It's simpler just to use the angles. So you have this signal with this being plus m and this being minus m. You have this signal. Let's think of this angle as pi, and this is 2 pi. You will get this signal and periodic repetition of the signal. Okay, so the phi t for A less than d is going to be 0, and for A greater than d, greater than equal to d, well, it's going to be 0 up to this point. Okay, and what is this angle? This angle is precisely when do you get this angle? When the input has precisely become d, okay, which means d is equal to A sine alpha, or in other words, alpha is sine inverse of d by A. So this angle here is alpha. Then of course you can calculate what this angle is, and it should be clear that this angle is pi minus alpha. This angle here is going to be pi plus alpha, and this angle here is going to be 2 pi minus alpha. Okay, and so the output signal, if you want to describe the output signal for magnitude A, the input magnitude greater than d, then this signal is going to be 0 for theta less than alpha. Okay. Perhaps I'll write it in the next page. So the output phi of t for A greater than equal to d is going to be 0 for angle 0 is less than theta is less than alpha, and then it is going to be plus m for alpha less than equal to theta less than equal to. Okay, so I shouldn't be using less than equal to, but I guess you understand what I mean by that, pi minus alpha. Then it's again 0 for pi minus alpha less than theta. Maybe I'll just consistently not use less than only for the lower limit, and for the upper limit less than equal to pi plus alpha. And it's going to be minus m pi plus alpha less than theta less than equal to, so let me call it phi of theta less than equal to 2 pi minus alpha, and then it's again going to be 0 2 pi. So the full cycle is given in that way as we had drawn earlier. Yeah, this being alpha, this being pi minus alpha, pi plus alpha, 2 pi minus alpha. This is 2 pi, this here is pi, 0. Okay, so now if we have to now calculate the primary harmonic, again, this is again an odd function, so we can straight away say that all the CIs are going to be 0. Okay, all the CKs are going to be 0. But we, of course, only interested in finding B1, and so if you have to calculate B1, B1 turns out to be 1 by pi integral 0, or rather 2 by pi integral 0 to pi of phi of theta sine theta d theta. Okay, so how much is this? Well, this integral from 0 to pi can further be broken down into 0 to alpha, which will be 0, and pi minus alpha to pi, which is also 0. So what is just left is alpha to pi minus alpha of phi theta, there is m, so I pull out the m and I just have sine theta d theta, and this turns out to be 2m by pi, and I'll have minus cos theta, so okay, so I have 2 times cos of alpha. So what this means is that for this particular nonlinearity that we are looking at, phi of A, I mean, I am suppressing the omega, because when you give the input to be sine omega t, then for the output, so the input is psi t and the output is phi t, and then the primary harmonic of the output is going to be 4m by pi cos alpha times sine omega t. Okay, of course, this cos alpha, you can write this down because we already know that alpha, or sine alpha we know, is d by a, and therefore the cos alpha is going to be square root of we can write this cos alpha in terms of a and d, which are parameters that came from the nonlinearity. Therefore, in this particular case, the describing function, and again here, the describing function is independent of the omega, because every time you give a sine omega t, you will get a square wave of that kind. And when you calculate the b1 for the square wave, it would be like this. And so, phi of a is going to be 4m by pi cos alpha, but this is not the gain, the gain is pi a, so this is the gain, and the angle is going to be 0. So this again is the describing function for the nonlinearity which we showed in this way. Okay, so we have sort of calculated two different describing functions for two different nonlinearities. And so what we would do in the next lecture is talk about how we are going to use these describing functions in order to detect whether a given system has a limit cycle or not. Okay.